Let's talk about motivation. And most people come in to see me, they usually have something in mind that they want to work on, which is interesting because sometimes what they want to work on or the reason why they come in isn't actually the main problem. So I'm not trying to be arrogant and telling people what they really should be fixing or what the real problem is. Because like say someone's coming in for weight loss, which is obviously something that is, you know, important to them and they want to focus on. But if the cause of their weight loss is like poor digestion and high stress, then even though they're coming in to lose weight, how I would fix it is by addressing their stress and digestion and diet, in a sense of not necessarily dieting, but more like fixing the underpinning, the foundational stuff that is resulting in their symptom. Maybe a better example is like fatigue. Let's say someone has fatigue. Instead of giving them something for energy, I actually figure out why they're tired. Let's say they have poor sleep. Well, I should fix their sleep. What if they have poor sleep because they overthink and they have a busy mind? Then we're working on their nervous system. So I guess my point is sometimes people don't actually know what they want to fix. They know they want to feel better, but it's not always an obvious thing where it's like, I need you to help with my adrenal function because I'm having all these symptoms. They have symptoms that they don't like, but maybe it's their adrenal gland that's the ultimate issue and weak spot. I like when someone comes in and we start talking, we get a history and a picture of what's going on, and then we understand better what they want. Because a lot of people, they'll be like, well, I was told I should see a naturopath. I'm like, yeah, that's good advice. But why do you want to see a naturopath? Like, what do you want to fix? And they'll be like, I thought I wanted to fix this thing. But then now having spoken to you, now there's all these other things that you're saying is wrong with me, which isn't meant to make them feel worse, but is really more so to make them more aware of what their body's doing and why they're feeling what they feel. Like that analogy of the iceberg, and the tip of the iceberg is just a small component of everything underneath that's creating the problem in relation to their symptoms. So all the stuff underneath is what we have to fix. What they come in for is the stuff that they see, which makes sense. Because a lot of times people will come in and be like, I'm great, I'm feeling good. And then you investigate and evaluate things and you're like, there's all these things that are kind of just getting by or you're compensating for. You don't feel that? And they're like, no, not really. And then they're like, well, how do you feel when you get sick? Well, I never get sick. It's usually a good sign that these are people that are on the brink of disaster. Like it's normal to get sick. So if you don't ever, your body's probably just so wiped out trying to put out fires, it doesn't have the response to kind of heal and respond to viruses, bacteria, that sort of thing. The idea of having motivation and discipline in what you want to do, it involves actually knowing exactly what has to be worked on. Someone says, I want to feel better. It's like, well, okay, you want to feel stronger, you want to be healthier, you want to, you know, have a fit body composition, you want to have good energy, you want to sleep better, you want to have a better mood. How are you going to do all these things? You can just take a bunch of pills? I don't think that's the solution. And then you start looking at their lifestyle and you'd be like, okay, what's not working for you? Okay, you go to bed way too late. Why do you go to bed too late? Well, because I work and I don't have any downtime. I'm like, okay. So then what do you do on your downtime? Like in the evening? Well, I don't know. I'm kind of preoccupied with things. So you never feel like you relax anyways. So either we set aside time for you actually have downtime and an escape and you remove yourself from the space that you do your best, worst thinking, or we have to reframe what your mindset is throughout the day. Because some people don't know how to shut it off. They don't know when the end of the workday is, because to them it never ends. their phone, they're always on call. There's always an email to reply to. There's always something to worry about. There's always a list to start to continue to check off. But when do you actually be like, okay, it's the end of the workday? When you're a kid, you have the end of the school day in theory. School day is over. You have some homework. And then you start seeing the problem in childhood, because a lot of kids come in really, really, really stressed, and you realize they actually don't ever stop doing homework. They're the type of kids that they'll spend 4 hours doing something that probably should have taken half an hour, or that they'll redo something until they're happy with it. And it sounds like not a lot of kids, but it's actually becoming more and more of the mainstream. When I was young, I was the odd guy that would do his homework. But the homework was almost optional when I would remember. It was kind of like an extra. Now, most of the school work is done at home, because there's a lot of stuff to be covered in class. I don't know. I'm not going to touch that topic. So back to my original idea. You actually have to have a way to know what you need to do and what you need to work on. There's so much redefining that's going into, like, the workday, home life, downtime. How do you reset? Resetting is not simply just falling asleep at night and waking up and you're like, oh, I should have energy. If from the start of the day until you're physically falling back into bed, if your brain doesn't shut off at some point, who's saying your brain shuts off during your sleep? These are people that sleep very light. They're very superficial sleepers. Their brain, it's like they're watching a movie of their life throughout the evening when they're asleep, and they wake up and it's just a blur. It's another day, blurs to the next day. I try to make people realize that doing nothing sometimes is very beneficial. And doing nothing can be physically doing nothing, or doing something that's not consequential. That's something that doesn't matter. I'm a big fan of, like, game time, downtime, escaping. If someone told me that they read fantasy novels, I'd be like, good for you. Do that. Do that regularly. I look forward to reading my novel. I'm almost finished one. I got another two in the series. That's amazing. That's good. If someone says, I watch something at 9 o'clock, and then I watch the news, and then I'm on my computer anyways, and I go to bed. I'm like, you're a miserable person. Yeah. So not always does a person know what they want to work on or what they want to fix, because they don't have a clear definition of what health is, or downtime, or recovery, or what their even initial concerns are. A lot of people are caught up in purely the symptom. How do I have symptom relief? It's like, well, if your symptoms are a manifestation of a bunch of lifestyle choices, you can erase the symptoms, but you're not changing the lifestyle, which eventually will just beget another symptom and a deeper one too. That's another concept that in this kind of line of work, symptoms are often initially superficial, and it's a check engine light. And if you don't address it, it goes deeper. And deeper means more of a significant symptom, a deeper, more of a significant issue at a physiological level. Like, for example, someone could sneeze if they eat something. And then if they keep eating it, they don't sneeze, but they have, like, stomach pain. And if they keep eating it, they don't have stomach pain, they get eczema. And if they don't stop eating it, and their eczema becomes a tendency for pneumonia. Like, some people would say, well, those are all unconnected, unrelated things. And I would say, think again. They're just an evolution of the same concern. Your body's not being able to break something down. Initial response, you ignored it. Second, third, fourth, keep ignoring it. Eventually becomes not only chronic, but could be terminal. I did mute my phone. It's my other phone. Mr. Two Phones. Yeah. So, trying to teach people how to, like, reevaluate what illness and health is the main issue. Because, you know, there's a million supplements. There's a lot of them that are really good too. But none of them change how you think, really. None of them change your lifestyle. That's the real pill that you have to learn how to swallow. How do you change the actions that are making you sick? And a lot of people, they don't like hearing that. They're like, I work hard and I accomplish. I'm like, that's good. Work hard. But then when do you balance it off? If you think of health and life as like we do live in a duality, in a sense, where it's like there's night and day, there's up and down, there's hot and cold. You can't just work hard and not offset it. Everything kind of has to have a check and balance. So that's what I'm saying. And then it goes both ways. There's people who are very inactive, exceedingly, excessively inactive. They need work. I've had both. I've had people in the same conversation, in the same room. One person, I said, you need to work more. The other person, I said, you need to work less. And they have the same problem. But they didn't understand how it manifests in different ways for different people. And it has to be very specific to the needs and the function of that individual. So most people kind of already know what I'm talking about. They intuitively get it. They're like, listen, I know what you're saying. You're right. I should be getting away more often. I should be leaving the office a little. I can. These are not situations where people are like, I'm desperately trying to put food on the table. I need to work. These are, no, I'm fine. I just choose to. So there's a consequence. It's choices. So you have to know that it's a physical, not just mental, not just emotional. Do you know what I'm saying? So you need to know what you want, and you have to be willing to compensate for the things that you do to get there. So if you work really, really, really hard and you sacrifice, that's good. But you can't just have the gas pedal down full all the time. Your car doesn't like it. Your body doesn't like it either. You have to have a way to like ease off. I tell people shifting up and down conserves your energy and your engine so you can last longer as opposed to burning out. People who sprint through life, they don't last. It is a marathon.